So let's go back to the slide set. I will not stick to the slide set all the time. Maybe not put the widgets at the exact location that are specified in the slide set, but just keep in mind that the slide set is fully sufficient to do the lab on your own. I'm just adding some tips or some more information, but the slide set is sufficient for you to do all the section of the lab. So this is starter screen, and we will start by adding a picture, a background picture. And for when we add this picture, we will add in fact all the images of the demo. So for the first part, but also the second, third, fourth, and fifth part. Then we will position correctly the background image. We will set names and specific attributes to each widgets. Some of them will be very important, so you'll have to put the exact names that are mentioned in this lab, in this slide set. The reason is that when we will add the specific code for the logic, which is not handled by the designer, we will refer to these names. So if the names are not correct, the application will not build. Well, fortunately, the error code we will get in this case will be quite obvious, but to save some time, just stick to the exact names. So then we will add the top bar of our interface and the animated image. So it's a specific widget that displays automatically different step of an animation. So the input of this widget is a set of images corresponding each one to a step of animation. So we will add 10 images for this animation, and we will set it on a loop, looping and in a loop animation here, with a specific time interval for each image, and this will automatically be handled by the JazzFX library. And then we will use only the designer to generate the code first, corresponding to the layout, and then run the simulator to see it on the PC, and finally run on a target. So let's go back to the TouchFX designer. So the first thing we will do is add the background image. So here we are in the custom container view. Let's go back to the screen and add the background image. So just single clicking on the widget will add it. You do not have to double click. Otherwise, you will add two widgets instead of one. And we have several ways to add images. First is to go to the image on the right panel. So the right panel corresponds to all the attributes of the selected widget. If I select the background, I have only the screen. And if I select the image widget, I have the attributes of the widget. So let me put the right names. So the name of the widget will be background. The location, we will set it with the adding the by adding the correct image. So to add some images, we have several ways to do that. Either we can press on the so select use the image attribute, press on the plus button, and a dialog box will open. So here it's correctly, it's at the right place, but at location, but we can you can go like this and select all the images and click on the open button. This will add all the images in the system, in the layout, in fact, in the project itself. So that means that all these images will be converted into C code, into C tables, and included in the final binary file. We can have a view of this file in the image panel And for example, in our lab, we use only one of these two. We have two in the lab in the part three. We will add a temperature sensor indication, and we will use only one. So this one will be included in the project anyway, which we do not want. So we can remove this one. But just be aware that if you are doing several tests with different, I don't know, different color format for images or a different layout, if you do not remove them explicitly from the image panel, they will be still included in your final project, thus taking some external flash space. So be aware of that. And the other way, so to add images is to use it from the from the image panel and add images right here. And another way is also to directly go to the file folder, to the folder hierarchy, sorry, and put the images in this folder, in the asset folder, in the touch.jfx folder. So you can see previously this one was empty. Now it contains all the input images in their original format. But still, the generated part is empty because we did not generate the code yet. So once we generated the code, this one will be filled with the conversion of the input images into C tables. So back to the canvas, let's select our background image and set the background we want. Of course, you can modify the size, and you can also can adapt to your screen. And even using the press, if you press the control key on your keyboard and use the wheel of the mouse, you can automatically zoom in and zoom out on your layout. Sometimes it's a bit tricky to set it properly, but once you understood, it's okay. Then we will add the top bar image. So again, it's a regular image. Select the top bar that we add at once with all the other images. And we can set the name of it. And the location is by default 0, 0, so we do not have to move it. And then we will add our animated image. So it's another widget that is located here. So we can set the location either using the direct attribute values, or we can drag and drop. And you can see that we have some guides that appear when we move the widgets. The guides are used to align. Here, for example, it aligns with the center, horizontal center line of the layout. When there are other widgets, it can be used, for example, a button. It can be used to align the widgets from another widget to another widget. So this specific widget has a name, as all widgets. The location is not very important, so I will put it, let's say, right in this lower left part of the layout. And we have to select the first image and the last image. So the first image will be the ne01.png. I can see that I'm close to the border, so I will just move my widget a little bit higher, and just for the appearance, it has no impact on the. I can even put it almost outside; it will still work. So, except that this part will never be processed. And the last image is the any 11.png. So that's it for the for what we wanted to do in this first lab. Except yes for the scheduling of this animation. So it will start as soon as the screen is entered. It could be triggered by the press of a button, or for example, if you use this kind of widget to display an animation, a loading animation, when you open a file, for example, it can be triggered. The start of the animation will be triggered by the pressing of the open button, for example. And I will display in loop on this animation. So as soon as it will reach the last image, it will go back to the beginning. And the display interval will be some 100 milliseconds. So that's it for the first lab, for the first layout, the layout of the first lab. So we can now generate the code. So in the meantime, I will display what I said. So the first generation will be quite long because it will process all the input images and convert them into C tables and create the associated CPP files. But this step will not be done anymore in the rest of the lab because we will not add any more images. And since the tools can detect that images have changed or not, the input images will not be needed to be regenerated. So clicking on the generate button, it was a bit fast, but there was a blue dot on this button. That means something has changed on the layout. The code is not up to date, and this blue dot will disappear. After. We will see that in the next step. So in the detail log, you can see that the input images are converted into CPP files, and they are created live when I'm talking, and then the post-generation function are called. So in this one, we will add the tool. We add these input images and also the very first screen implementation to the Visual Studio project, and also update the IDE selected in the CubeMX project. The IDE is the Cube STM32 Cube IDE. So now the source code is generated, and I will launch the simulator because it takes quite a long time for the first launch. You can see that here there is no more blue dots next to the generated code. That means that what is done in the designer is already has already been implemented in C code. So in this code, there was not much changes in the screen part, except for there is now a screen run presenter. This one will be in charge of the logic of the application. For the moment, there is no other logic than updating the animated widget. We'll extend that with the during the lab. So I will accelerate this step. So now the build is done, and the simulator opened on another window. So here it is. So this is what we will observe also on the board when we will flash it. Let me show you where we were previously in the simulator folder. The Visual Studio project is now available. It has been created during the post-generation step when we press the generate code. And if I open this solution, here it is from another screen. So I can exactly run the simulator the same way. So using this time the Visual Studio toolchain instead of the GCC makefile. That is used from the designer, And the main advantage is that I can put some breakpoints inside the source code. So here I use the Microsoft Visual Studio Express 2015, which is the last free version that was available for Microsoft. The new one is called Community and is not for free for professional use. So in this case, you will have to buy a license for a Visual Studio license if you want to use this feature. So this is the end of the first part of the lab. Let's go now to the interactions.